So in this particular semester, that is in semester 6, there is a departmental elective 2, and in that departmental elective 2, we have a total 3 subjects. So that 3 subjects are, first one is 6011 with subject code special electrical machines, then second subject is energy storage, and third subject is high voltage engineering. Out of these 3 subjects, department have offered 2 subjects as a elective, and we have circulate a Google form for taking your interest about the elective subject. So we have offered 2 subjects as a elective. One is the special electrical machines, and the second subject is energy storage. But as out of total number of students, only 9 to 10 students are interested for energy storage. So we have taken a decision related to the compulsory elective, which is a special electrical machine. So due to the lesser number of students interested for the energy storage, we have cancelled that particular subject as a elective, and we have offered only one elective subject, that is a special electrical machines. Okay. So now this is actually the extension part of your electrical machines part. So up till now you have learned the number of electrical machines starting from semester 3. So in semester 3, there is a DC machine, and in semester 4, DC machine part have been covered in semester 3. In semester 4, there is a AC machines, electrical AC machines 1. So in that electrical AC machines 1, you have learned the asynchronous machine, which is actually the induction machine, and second one is the transformers. Now in electrical AC machines 2, that is in semester 5, there is a synchronous machine part. Okay. So up till now you have learned all conventional machines, conventional rotating machines, as well as the stationary machines like a transformer, which are widely used in actual power system, starting from generation up to consumption. So basically at the generation part, there are synchronous generators, which are generally termed as alternators, and that alternators generate electricity. At consumer part, that is at consumption level, we have different motors like three-phase induction motors, single-phase induction motors. In some applications, we might be used a DC machines. So these all machines are generally used for certain consumption or at a consumer, means at a load end. Now in between this, to increase and decrease the voltage level, we generally use a transformers. That transformers is also one of the type of electrical machines. So these transformers are basically used for rising or falling, or rising or decreasing the voltage levels, which are suitable for a transmission and a distribution purposes. Okay. So that transformer is also one of the part of AC machine, but that machine is actually the stationary machine, which is only used to rise or decrease the voltage level from one value to another value. So each and every machine which is used in these particular applications, that every machine has some its special characteristics and special performance, and we generally use for we use all that particular machines in wide range of applications in actual power systems. Okay. Now these all are whatever machines which I have explained till now, that all machines are generally the conventional machines. Okay, that may be conventional rotating machines, or that may be stationary machine like a transformer. So these conventional rotating machines like a DC machines, induction machines, and synchronous machines are mainly used for the bulk energy conversion. The basic motto of any electrical machine is to convert one form of energy into another form, like electrical to mechanical or mechanical to electrical, and so on. So machine is simple, the electromechanical energy conversion device, and in power system, all these conventional machines are used to convert one form of energy into another form in a bulk level. That means for large value or for a high power conversion, these all machines are used. Okay, so these are generally used for a bulk energy conversion. Now, extensive studies were conducted on all these machines, and massive information is available in document forms. So number of energies or number of studies were already conducted all these on all these machines, and there is a massive information which is available now, and that massive information is generally utilized to understand these various conventional machines. Now, instead of this conventional electrical machines, there are several other types of electrical machines which are generally used for the which are generally invented, especially that machines are generally invented for some special applications, and all these particular machines belongs to a special electrical machines. Okay, so along with all these conventional machines, certain machines are there which are especially invented and that are used for certain special applications. Therefore, all these machines are generally termed as a special electrical machines. Okay, now what are these special electrical machines? So the different machines which are termed as a special electrical machines are a stepper motor, switch reluctance motor, permanent magnet DC or AC motors, then brushless DC motor, which is also known as BLDC motor, linear electrical machines, which is also termed as a linear induction motor or LIM, permanent magnet axial flux machines. So all these machines belongs to the special electrical machines because all that machines have certain special applications. These are not used for the conventional energy conversion from one form to another form, but these machines are generally invented for some special applications like some control technologies, some robotics, or some another applications. We are going to study that application part in detail also. Therefore, these machines generally term as a special electrical machines. Now, electrical machines developed for a specific applications are generally termed as a special electrical machines. Now, till 1916, their applications were limited due to the cost and complexity of a controller, which were essential for the full utilization of their potential. So special or the basic important component of the special electrical machine is a controller. So due to the till 1916, there are certain limitations and complexity in these controller designs. Therefore, till 1916, these machines were not widely used for the different applications. But now after 1960s, there is a rapid development in the semiconductor technologies and digital control systems. So in last few decades, again, this particular development is increases to a massive level. Therefore, the implementation of fast and accurate control scheme could be realized. Okay, so due to development in the semiconductor technologies and due to development in these controllers, now we can implement this particular semiconductor technologies and digital control system in the faster developments in actual electrical machines part, that is in special electrical machines part. So at present, a large number of institutions and industries are actively involved in the research which is related to the special electrical machines for further improvement in construction and performance of these machines. So various research activities are continuously going on the constructional part of the special electrical machines, on control part of that special electrical machines, and this particular research work will definitely help us to improve the current special electrical machines controlled and construction to a certain extent. Okay, so this research is continuously going on. Now, as a you can say that advanced type of course, the number of universities include this particular syllabus like a special electrical machines as an elective for undergraduate students. And our university have also introduced this syllabus in your recent C scheme, that is 2019's revised scheme. So these particular technologies, these particular machines are very important. And these machines are generally used for the special applications. So the basic motto of introducing this syllabus in your curriculum is to understand the construction, working, and especially control of a special electrical machines. Okay, so the basic course objective is to impart knowledge on special electrical machines and its control. Okay. So now, if you look towards the teaching scheme, so this particular subject have total 3 theory lectures, no practical and tutorials. So the total theory hours are 3. Again, 3 credits assigned for theory, no credit will be there for tutorial and practical. So total credit is again 3. Now, what will be the examination scheme? So now, there will be 2 internal assessments, each for 20 marks. You are familiar with this. So average will be considered as an internal assessment marks. There is an in-same examination of 80 marks with duration of 3 hours. So total subject is of 20 plus 80, that is of 100 marks. There will be no any term work and no oral practical examination for this particular subject. So only 100 mark weightage is there for this elective, that is 20 mark internal assessment and 80 mark end sem examination. Now, as I have already told, the main course objective of this course is to impart knowledge on a special electrical machines and its control. So that is the basic motto or basic objective of this particular course. Now, there are total 6 course outcomes. So after completion of this particular course, the learner must be able to or will be able to. First outcome is to exemplify the working of a stepper motor and its control. How to illustrate the working of stepper motor and its control. Next one is to demonstrate the function of SRM, that is switch reluctance motor, and its control. Okay. Third important course objective is to illustrate the working of BLDC motor and its control. That BLDC is what? It is the brushless DC motor. Okay. So to illustrate the work, fourth course objective is to illustrate the operational feature of a PMSM motor and its control. This PMSM is what? Permanent magnet synchronous motor. Okay. So that is the fourth course objective. The fifth course objective is to illustrate the operational feature of a synchronous reluctance motor and its control. Okay, so that is fifth course objective. And last one is related to the linear induction motor. That is to illustrate the working of LIM, which is linear induction motor. So these are the course outcomes, and the learner must be, or learner will be able to fulfill this particular course outcome after successful completion of this particular course. Now let's see the syllabus of this particular course in detail. So our first module is a stepper motor and its control. Okay. So especially this stepper motor is also known as a position control motor. Okay. Now this module is for 7 hours. So now what is this stepper motor? Actually, in various control system applications, the position control is an important task. I think in CS1 you have learned this position control. Okay, so the position control is an important task in many applications. So conventionally, this task is carried out using DC servo motor with a gearbox. I think you have studied this DC servo motor in control system 1. So that DC servo motor is generally used for the position control in a different application. So that DC servo motor consists a gearbox, a position sensor, error detector, and an amplifier for activating this servo motor. Okay, so whatever servo motor is there, that servo motor consists amplifier, error detector, and a position sensor, and that will give the activation command to this DC servo motor. Now the motor, being a velocity servo, detection of a position error is necessary. So in AC servo motors, a two-phase AC servo motor is used in place of the DC servo motor. So there are 2 different types of these servo motors, either DC servo motors or AC servo motors. So in AC servo motor, generally two-phase AC servo motors is used instead of DC servo motor. So with the advancement in the digital computers, an urgent need was felt for an electromechanical actuator, which can be directly driven by a digital pulse from the computer for the accurate position of device. And that accurate position of device are generally nothing but the printer heads, the machine tools, and this particular control is necessary. So for running these computer peripherals, the simple control device is required. A simple device is required which can move a discrete angular position by taking a simple digital signal as an input. Okay, and this particular device which can simply generates or which can simply move through a discrete angular position after receiving the control signal or after receiving the digital signal as an input is nothing but simple the stepper motor. Okay, so stepper motor generally moves through a discrete angular position by taking the digital signal directly as an input, with each input pulse rotating a shaft by a certain discrete angle. Okay, so once that motor will receive certain input signal, it will rotate that shaft with some discrete angle. We are going to study that part in detail in this particular stepper motor. Okay, so a stepper motor itself is an the device which can generally use for a position control in the recent applications where the conventional position control have some disadvantages. So that conventional position control has various disadvantages which are using a servo motor. Okay, therefore all that position control applications are now replaced with the stepper motor. So again, there are various control strategies are used or implemented for this stepper motor. So we are going to study that control strategies in this particular chapter itself. So for that purpose, either we provide two different control strategies. One is by using a power converter circuits, and second one is by using a DSP, that is a digital signal processors, or the microcontroller based control. So we are going to study that particular part in detail in module number one. So in module one, which is related to stepper motor, we are going to learn features, constructions and applications, working of stepper motor, the open loop and closed loop characteristics, and different control strategies. So that is our first module for special electrical machines. Now module 2 is actually SRM motor, which is also known as a switch reluctance motor. So now what is switch reluctance motor? So switch reluctance motor can be basically described as a closed loop variable reluctance step motor with a position feedback and a relatively large step angle. So it is actually one of the type of stepper motor, but actually that particular motor works in a closed loop. Okay, so it is a closed loop variable reluctance stepper motor with a position feedback and a relatively larger step angle as compared to the conventional stepper motor. So the different phases which are present in this switch reluctance motor are switch on and off at appropriate instances, which depends upon the position of a rotor, and therefore once we switch these particular steps in on and off, there is a formation of the pulsating energy flow, and that particular pulsating energy flow can be used to sense these particular different stages. Okay, so in this particular chapter we are going to study the various features, constructions, applications and working of this SR motor. Again, we are going to draw and study the open loop and closed loop control of this particular switch reluctance motor. So especially switch reluctance motor itself is the closed loop controlled stepper motor. So we are going to study that particular closed loop control in detail. Then we are going to discuss the various control strategies like a power converter circuits, DSP and microcontroller based control, and sensorless control for SR motor. Okay, so that is our part for chapter number 2. Now third part is very important, and that motor is actually widely used in various electric vehicle applications, which is actually BLDC motor or brushless DC motor. Okay, so now up till now you have learned the DC motor, which consists of brushes. Now these particular motors are generally brushless DC motor. So the motor, these particular motors generally known as a commutatorless DC motors also. Okay, so these particular motors have generally the field winding and that various sensing, that is 6 Hall sensors are there. And depending upon the signal which is received from that Hall sensor applications, these particular motors will work. Okay, so we taken a synchronous motor type step motor and it used in a closed loop operating using the control or position feedback system. The motor could have attained much higher speed and could have been used as a variable speed motor, which is equivalent to separately excited a DC motor. Such motors are generally termed as a BLDC motors or commutatorless DC motor. So if the wound field of the synchronous motor is replaced by the permanent magnets and its position feedback is used, we can avoid the slip rings and brushes. And if we avoid the slip ring and brush arrangement, now the commutatorless DC motors now comes under a new motor's control or new motor type, which is actually the BLDC motor. So in BLDC motor, generally the fields are replaced. Fields which are present in synchronous motors are generally replaced by the permanent magnet. So the rotor consists of a permanent magnet instead of certain winding. So as rotor consists of a permanent magnet, there is a no necessity of exciting that rotor winding with the external supply. So as rotor is not excited with external supply, the slip ring and brush arrangement is completely eliminated from a motor circuitry, and that comes under the BLDC motor. So in the recent years, there has been considerable developments in high energy density permanent magnets like a samarium cobalt and neodymium iron boron, that is the NdFeB magnets. Okay, and these particular magnets are used in case of BLDC motor as well as in conventional DC motor, where field winding is replaced by such magnets. Okay, so these magnets which I have told, like samarium cobalt and NeFeD or NdFeD. So NdFeB is actually neodynamic iron boron magnets. So these are actually the magnets which has higher flux density, okay, or higher field intensity, that is higher value of H. So in BLDC motors, these magnets are used on a rotor which produced the required amount of magnetic field. So instead of using the field winding, the field winding is simply replaced by such permanent magnets, and that permanent magnets has capable of producing the higher value of a magnetic field intensity which is required for motor operation. So as the field winding is replaced with the permanent magnets, so there is a no necessity of excitation current, and due to this, the brushes and slip ring arrangement is completely eliminated from conventional DC motor construction. Therefore, that motor comes under the BLDC motor, that is brushless DC motor. Okay, so basically these magnetic materials have relatively higher values of B and H, that is the field intensity and field density, that leads in the higher torque to volume ratio. Okay, therefore the relative permeability of these magnets is only a little greater than unity, that is the reluctance of a magnet is almost same as that of the air gap, having same dimensions as those of the magnets. So the relative permeability of this magnet, I think you are familiar with these all concepts, you have learned that concepts in basic of magnetism. So the relative permeability of this magnet is greater than unity, okay, and therefore the reluctance of this magnet is almost same as that of air gap with a same dimensions. Okay, so this is actually basics related to the BLDC motor. So in simple, only keep in mind, in BLDC motor the field winding is replaced with the permanent magnets, so there is no necessity of any excitation for field winding. As excitation is not required, therefore the brush and slip ring arrangement is completely eliminated from the DC motor construction, and the motor comes under brushless DC motor construction. So that is actually BLDC. So in this particular chapter, which is chapter number 3, we are going to study the construction of a BLDC motor in detail, its working principle. Then we are going to draw and study equivalent magnetic circuit. Then we required various converters for the operation of BLDC motor. So we are going to study that type of converters and their speed control. Then we are going to study the comparison between axial and radial permanent magnet motors and applications. Again, similar to the previous two motors, that is stepper and SR motor, we are going to study the open loop and closed loop control strategies like a power converter circuit using power converter circuit and DSP and microcontroller based control. Okay, so that control strategies for all motors are generally similar. Okay, but there is a, according to the type of inputs required, there might be certain variations in the control strategies, but the device which are used for controlling purpose, that devices are generally same. Either we use power converter circuits or we use DSP based control circuits or microcontroller based control circuits. So we are going to study all that particular concepts in module number 3, which is related to brushless DC machines and its control. Now fourth module is the permanent magnet synchronous machines and its control. Now I think you have learned this synchronous machine in semester 5. So a conventional synchronous machine has the electromagnetic field system. So that field system is usually mounted on a shaft of a machine that is on a rotor. So that rotating field winding has much more advantages over the stationary field in case of synchronous machine. Therefore, in synchronous machine, field winding is generally embedded on rotor slots. Okay, so you have studied that particular part in detail. What are the different advantages of this rotating field, or why this field winding is mounted on rotor in case of conventional synchronous machine? Okay, now these machines generally consist the pole body and winding, and these windings are excited with the voltage which is supplied through slip ring and brushes. When we talk about the synchronous motor, the armature winding is present on a stator, and that armature winding is excited with the AC supply. Okay, whatever field winding which is present on rotor, that field winding is generally excited with a DC supply through the brushes and slip ring arrangement. Now there is a certain constructional changes in permanent magnet synchronous motor, and this permanent magnet synchronous motor has the electromagnetic field system, but slip rings and brushes are replaced with the permanent magnet. That means all these slip rings and brushes are generally replaced with the permanent magnet. So the use of permanent magnets instead of electromagnets eliminates the field copper losses, brush friction losses, and brush and slip ring cost. Okay, so actually there is a not requirement of any field winding. There is a no requirement of any external supply for this field winding. Therefore, definitely the field copper losses are eliminated. There is no any friction loss between brush and the field circuit, whatever supply system is there, slip ring and brush arrangement. So no friction loss will be takes place in that slip ring and brush arrangement. Again, there is no requirement of brushes and slip rings also. And definitely this results in the higher efficiency of a PMSM motor as compared to the conventional synchronous motor or an induction motor. So as these losses have been completely eliminated, therefore the permanent magnet synchronous motor, that is PMSM motor, has the large advantage or higher efficiency as compared to the conventional synchronous motor and induction motor. So the advantage of these PMSM motors combines with the availability of advanced permanent magnets, which I have already told, whose cost is low, leads to the widespread use of the PMSM in several variable speed drives. So this PMSM motor is widely used in a variable speed drive applications. Okay, and continuous advancements in these, the magnetic material have been takes place that will ultimately decreases the cost of this magnet. And due to now the reduction in the cost of magnets, and due to the higher efficiency of this particular motor, widely this permanent magnet synchronous motor is used for variable speed drives application. So we are going to study that particular permanent magnet synchronous machines in module number 4. So again, we are going to discuss the features, construction, application and working of this permanent magnet synchronous motor. Then we are going to discuss the open loop and closed loop control strategies. Again, control strategies with the power converter circuit, DSP based circuit, and microcontroller based circuit. So as for every special purpose electrical machine, the control strategies are same. Either we use power converters or we use DSP based and microcontroller based circuitries or microcontroller based control. So these particular points we are going to discuss in module number 4, that is PMSM motor. Now module 5 is generally related to synchronous reluctance motor, which is also abbreviated as SYRM motor. Okay, synchronous reluctance motor. Now the conventional synchronous motor which you have learned in semester 5 has an armature in which the EMF of a machine is induced and an electromagnetic field to produce main magnetic field. Okay, so the main magnetic field is generally produced by the field winding which is present on the rotor. The armature, in armature, EMF of the of that particular machine is induced. Now in salient pole synchronous motor, in addition to the torque developed by interaction between magnetic field with the armature conductor or armature current, there is a certain torque is produced due to difference between these D axis and Q axis synchronous reactances. I think you have learned this particular direct axis and quadrature axis synchronous machine, that is D axis and Q axis synchronous machines. So in salient pole synchronous motor, there is a production of additional torque. So that additional torque is generally developed by the interaction of magnetic field with the armature current. So this is the main torque which is developed inside the motor, that is with the interaction of magnetic field with armature current. Along with this torque, a torque is also produced due to the difference between XD and XQ. That XD is nothing but the direct axis synchronous reactance. XQ is actually quadrature axis synchronous reactance. So this particular torque is also produced in the salient pole synchronous motor. I think you have drawn power angle characteristics of synchronous motor. So you have studied that two different torques. One torque is actually the electromagnetic torque and another torque is generally known as a reluctance torque. Okay, so that reluctance torque is generally developed due to the difference between XD and XQ. Okay, so the torque developed in the synchronous motor due to the difference between these two reluctances, XD and XQ, is generally known as the reluctance torque. And synchronous motor in which only the reluctance torque is developed is known as a synchronous reluctance motor. So at this moment, only keep in mind, in synchronous reluctance motor, there will be no any electromechanical torque or electromagnetic torque. There will be only the reluctance torque. I think if you recall the torque equation of synchronous motor, that consists two different torques. One torque is developed due to the electromechanical action, that is due to the armature interaction of armature conductor and magnetic field, main magnetic field. Another torque is developed due to the difference between direct axis reactance XD and quadrature axis reactance XQ. So that torque is generally termed as a reluctance torque. And in case of the synchronous reluctance motor, only reluctance torque is developed. There will be no any electromechanical torque. Okay. So now, in case of synchronous reluctance motor, again armature is on stator and the rotor has the projecting poles without any winding or permanent magnets. So there is a constructional difference, that is, there is no winding present on rotor. No permanent magnets are there, but that rotor is generally made up of some projecting poles, and the speed of this particular synchronous reluctance motor depends upon the frequency and the number of poles for which the armature is wounded. So that is actually the dependency of speed. Okay, speed depends upon the frequency and the number of poles for which that armature winding is wounded. Now the synchronous reluctance motors are generally simple and robust in construction due to absence of winding, field winding on or permanent magnet on rotor circuitry. So it is actually very cheap than that of the conventional synchronous and induction motor. Again, as field winding is absent, there is no field copper loss, and efficiency of this motor is also higher. So we are going to study this particular synchronous motor. Actually, where we use this motor, so at present, these motors are used in low power applications where synchronous operations of many motors is required. So this motor name itself is the synchronous reluctance motor that will operate on a synchronous speed. So we use these particular motors for a very low power applications. where we replace a synchronous motor, conventional synchronous motor, with the synchronous reluctance motor. So we are going to study that synchronous reluctance motor in detail in the module number 5. With its construction working, we are going to discuss the phasor diagrams, we are going to derive the torque equation for synchronous reluctance motor, then we are going to study different control strategies like direct axis current control, fast torque response control, and then advantages and applications. So that is related to our module number 5. Module number 6 is related to linear induction machines, actually that is LIM. So there are certain industrial applications where direct linear motion is preferable. So whatever machines, I think if you look towards machines, you only recall the rotary operations, that is the rotational motions of that machine. But there are various applications in industries where we require a linear motion, like say traction, or maybe in belt conveyors. And in these particular applications, we generally use the linear induction motor. Okay, so generally in such devices, the rotary motion is converted into linear motion using a wheel rail or wheel belt adhesion. So if this adhesion is not adequate, the wheel will slip and this wheel limits the ultimate speed of the vehicle. Okay, and in other words, the adhesion or friction between wheel and rail is very essential. So generally we replace this conventional rotary to linear conversion by a simple linear induction motor. So these linear induction motors have a topology somewhat different from the conventional rotary machines, such as the short primary, long secondary, or long primary, short secondary, etc. And generally these are used for the linear motion applications only. Okay, so in such applications where we require linear motions, we generally replace the conventional rotary to linear conversion using a linear induction machine. So we are going to study that linear induction machines in module number 6. So in this module, we are going to discuss the construction, type of linear induction motors, its working features, then thrust equation, which is the important part related to linear induction machine. That is the thrust equation. So we are going to discuss that thrust equation. Then we will study equivalent circuit, characteristics, and control. Okay, so that is the syllabus for linear induction motor. So in this way, in this syllabus subject, we have to discuss these 6 different types of special machines which have been invented and widely used for various special applications. Okay, so that is the rough overview of entire syllabus for electrical special electrical machines subject. Now, what are the different books which you can use for this particular course? So I will suggest two books. I'm going to suggest two books for you. The one book is first, that is E.G. Janardhanan. So entire syllabus is present in this E.G. Janardhanan. So for all 6 topics, you can refer this E.G. Janardhanan. Book name is Special Electrical Machines with PHR Publication. Second book is K. Venkatratnam, Special Electrical Machines, University Press Publication. So in this particular book, K. Venkatratnam, you will find 4 different modules which are there in our syllabus. That is stepper motor, then switch reluctance motor, after that BLDC motor, and linear induction motor. So module number 1, module number 2, module number 3, and module number 6. That 4 modules are there in this book, Special Electrical Machines, which is written by K. Venkatratnam. Okay. For these 2, 4, and 5, you have to refer simply E.G. Janardhanan. All these 6 modules have been there in first E.G. Janardhanan book. So you can refer that book directly for your subject preparation. Again, there are certain reference books. So in this particular reference section, for permanent magnet synchronous motor and BLDC motor, you can use reference of K. Krishnan. So K. Krishnan, the book name itself is the Permanent Magnet Synchronous and Brushless DC Motor. Those who are interested for some additional work or additional understanding, they can use this reference book. If you have to do certain courses which are related to this special electrical machines, then you can refer these two different courses, that is NPTEL courses, Advanced Electrical Drives by S.P. Das, and second one is Fundamentals of Electrical Drives by Dr. S.P. Das. So these two website courses are also available. NPTEL courses are also available for further understanding. So that is related to the entire overview of our special electrical machine syllabus. From next lecture, we are going to start our actual syllabus from module number 1, that is with a stepper motor. Okay. Now, basically, this syllabus is a theoretical point of view. There are certain derivations, some numericals will be also there. But for examinations, the percentage-wise ratio is 80-20, 80% theory and 20% numericals. So that is the percentage-wise ratio for this particular course. Okay, so we have to solve certain numericals from the stepper motor and BLDC motor. Especially, maximum numericals will be there from BLDC and stepper. Might be some small numericals, 5-mark numerical will be there from remaining 4 chapters. Actually, in linear induction motor, there will be no any numericals. Okay, because that syllabus is not focused in detail for numerical related view for this module number 6. So might be 20% numericals will be there in your final examinations. So we are going to discuss that numericals also in actual syllabus. So subject is interesting, and now this is actually recent subject which is actually used in so these particular technologies related to special electrical machines are actually used in various industrial applications. Okay, so accordingly, keep your focus on this particular subject. Now, okay, so that is related to the entire syllabus for the subject.